Your friend and longtime advisor, Karen Hughes, told me recently the combination of the rising opposition to the Iraq war and then Katrina came right at that moment. She said it cast what she called a, quote, huge shadow over the rest of the presidency. Is that a fair assessment?
You know, the historians will judge that, John.
Was it harder, though, to get things done?
Well, I tried to get immigration reform done and it didn't happen, and Social Security reform. And those two issues didn't take place. I don't think it was because of any shadows. I think it was because, one, Congress is reluctant to take on, was reluctant to take on a difficult issue like Social Security. In other words, the legislative body tends to be reactive, and until a crisis is imminent, it's hard to get them to move forward. And on immigration reform, a populist streak hit during the midst of the debate and made it difficult to do. But, you know, the job of the president is to look beyond the moment and anticipate problems and encourage a legislative body to move. Eventually, these problems will get solved.
And elements of your party abandoned you on immigration.
And Social Security.
Do you feel a sense of redemption now when you see leaders in the party saying we have to do something that looks a whole lot like Bush McCain Kennedy?
I don't really view it as redemption. I view it as smart and logical. And I was real proud of my little brother being out there, you know, pushing the issue because he understands the issue well. Eventually, these problems will get solved. And a president just has to understand that not every issue gets solved during his presidency, but he can contribute to the ultimate solution.
I want to ask each of you, looking back now that you're removed from the daily politics, and you, especially at the end of the presidency, was a pretty polarizing time. How much do you think that the angst about Katrina, the opposition to the Iraq war, just hardened some people so that they just couldn't see other things? I'll mention PEPFAR, for example.
Yeah.
Remarkable work against malaria and AIDS in Africa. The Medicare prescription drug benefit, which under budget, according to most costs, and yet many of your fellow Republicans say, you know, why did George W. Bush give us this liberal entitlement?
You know, John, I'm really not that concerned about why people did what during my presidency. I'm more concerned about being an effective person for the rest of my life. I know this, that Laura and I gave the presidency 8 years of our life. We gave it our all, made the best judgment calls I could. I didn't compromise my principles, and I'm a content man. And I am excited about what we're gonna do here.
You've made two trips to Africa since leaving office, and I understand there's a third one coming up.
Yes, sir.
What draws you there?
The human condition. I think it's important to set priorities in life. I always said that one of the principles that was important to me was human life. We went to Africa and saw people dying, needlessly dying, and there's nothing more important, I think, and Laura thinks as well, to help somebody live. And so during my presidency, I convinced Congress to spend taxpayers' money to save lives, not only from HIV, but as well as from malaria, and it worked. And we want to continue that type of work with cervical cancer.
This will bring your team together.
Yes, it will.
For the dedication, and we've talked to a lot of them in recent days. At the end of the presidency, there was some strain with your vice president over some policy disagreements in the second term over the Scooter Libby pardon decision. Is that relationship still strained? Has it been?
No, it was never strained. That's I think that's the mythology that's that we've escaped. In other words, there's a mythology in Washington. There's a kind of a.
Well, he writes in his book that things were tense.
Not really. They were on Scooter Libby. Yeah, he didn't agree with that decision, but I don't. You know, people ought to look at the total picture, and we're friends then and friends now.
Can you enlighten us to the painting? George W. Rembrandt?
George was looking for a pastime, actually, when he gave up smoking cigars. So he read Churchill's book, Painting is a Pastime. And he's actually very good. He's a very good painter.
What do you get from it?
A lot of things, John. I relax. I see colors differently. I am I guess tapping a part of the brain that, you know, certainly never used when I was a teenager. And I get the satisfaction out of completing a project. And I paint people's pets, and I'd love to give them their pet as a gift. Now, I readily concede the signature is more valuable than the painting.
He's become a pet portrait painter.
It's hard to say if you say it quickly.
This is my second dedication of a Bush Presidential Library.
There you go.
I was at your father's. I'm happy to be at this one. Will I ever go to a third?
That's a good question. You know, I don't know. I think because of his example, his grandchildren and children admire his service and realize you can go into the public arena and not lose your soul. And that you can be a good father and still be a political figure. He's been an inspiration for me, obviously, but as well, brothers, sister, and grandchildren. And there's no telling. There is a nephew, George P. Bush, who is on the hustings here in Texas. And
you're not skipping Jeb, are you?
Well, Big Jeb, you know, he's got a decision to make. And if I could make it for him, it'd be run, but I can't. And I don't know what he's going to do. He'd be a great candidate and a great president. But I do know his son, George P., has made up his mind, and he's running for General Land Commission in Texas, an important position, and I think will do very well if given the chance to serve.
You prefer the post-presidency to the presidency?
No, I loved it, too. I mean, I've loved every part of our life, from when we were in Midland, Texas, to those 8 years at the White House. It was a huge privilege to live at the White House and serve the American people. And here, back home in Dallas.
Thank you both so much for your time, and congratulations and good luck with this place.
Yeah, thanks, John.
Thank you.